Welcome, welcome everybody to this webinar, How to Describe Visual Things to Visually Impaired People. This webinar is made under the project Path to Inclusion that is created under the Erasmus Plus Key Action 2 founding. The biggest aim is to promote mixability group activities, so to encourage the youth worker as a local level to welcome in their activities, in their daily work, some youngster with disabilities. So the team who is working behind the project create a platform that is inclusionplatform.eu, where you can find several tool information for start to work with mixability group. In the website inclusionplatform.eu there is the webinar section where we are now. There is a toolkit where there are several technical information in working in mixability group, and there is a map of activities who are accessible and hopefully also inclusive among Europe. So basically you can go in the map, search close to your place, close to you, which kind of activities are provided for who. So according to the target that there is in your group of your community, you can organize some excursions, some activities, some enjoyable moment for your youngs. Let's introduce myself. I'm Lorenzo Tassoni from Italy. I am one of the founder of one organization called Esplora that is based in central of Italy. Esplora works a lot with Erasmus Plus and youth project, and set up a program that is called the Viaggi Diffusi, that was based especially with experiential tourism, and after step by step increase in accessible tourism, especially for blind and also for deaf, sensorial deficit. According to years of experience, now with this webinar, I will try to share and to give to you all my knowledge, or a lot of information that I can share with you in case you need to describe something to visually impaired. For example, you are walking in the street and it's full of things that could be described, but how I should do it, how I have to do it, why yes or why not. If you would like, maybe we can go deeper for who want to set up a real accessible tour in their museum. So all the technique and the material and the tools that you need if you want to make accessible your museum, for example. So the main target of this webinar, like the target of the project, basically is a youth worker who is approaching in this field, working with the visually impaired in the case of this webinar. There is also another webinar handed by me in this section and our YouTube channel that is how to set up a trip for visual impaired. As you can see, the webinar focuses a lot on the role of the companion, and also in this case, for this webinar, the companion is the person who is describing, who is saying to the traveler what is going on around them. Anyway, we strongly believe that a trip need the institutional moment, we call it, so institutional visit of museum, of churches made by professional guided and made with the correct tool. Okay. We strongly recommend you, when you are making and you are planning and you are organizing a trip, to find the good visit made in a certain way, let's say studied and well done. Okay, describing is not easy things. If you try to do it and you think in a person who cannot see, well, it became a bit quite tough. Describing is difficult for several reasons. One of these one is that for sure you have to skip details. You have to skip detail because basically the things that you can describe are infinite. The details that you can tell to your traveler are really infinite. So you have to choose, let's say, what to say or what to not say. For example, the color, maybe many people didn't saw in the past of their life, so they don't need it to get in the detail of the colors. When you're describing a room, because you enter in a room, so you describe where we are. So this is the whole what you can say. You can describe which painting are on the floor. You can describe the disposition of the furniture in this place. You can get lost, I mean, in the details. So you have to choose what to say. With visual things, we mean also the tactile things, the things that can be touched, like the statues, because basically before touching or during touching the statue, for example, is good to describing. It's good to say what you are going to touch. And so before start touching, give an hint to what they are going to touch. Or maybe because a statue is big, no, you touch just a particularity, a part of it, like the muscles of the leg of the empire from Rome. So you want to touch the work of the sculpture, the very well detailed muscles, and so on, but you have to know what there is around your touching. Okay? So let's share the screen and let's start our webinar. So again, how to describe visual things to visually impaired people. So some foreword. The reason of the traveler is very important to help us to describe them the things. So we know why they are with us traveling. We know what they are looking for in during our trip. Another important aspect to take in consideration while you're describing is what I'm describing. How far is from my culture? We are in front of a Gothic church. So I ask to my traveler, my friend, do you know the Gothic windows? The colorful Gothic windows. Do you know that Gothic church are full of beautiful, colorful windows? Yes, no. So if I know that the traveler knows already about Gothic windows, for example, I will not go too much in the detail in this case because we are here to see another part of the church. So we will not focus in the windows. But if my traveler, that maybe is a youngster from Italy, where we don't have many Gothic churches, well, probably I need to focus in the windows because it's a particularity of the Gothic style, architectonic, and it's important then to share with my traveler. So this symbology and these particularities of the Gothic style, probably it's important to underline because my traveler doesn't know it before. So I have to describe and decide which aspect I have to focus on. Basically, I would like to speak more about the symbology of the gargoyle in the Gothics, or we have to focus in the reason why the Gothic is that high. So in this prospection, let's say to God direction. So what I have to underline in my describing. So related to this, I should somehow be empathic with my traveler in the sense that I have to understand what he is looking for, which kind of information he's looking for. Make similitudes is also very good. Make the life easier for descriptor and the traveler. I don't know, similitude with something that you presume the people, the traveler knows properly. Okay, so some technical formal step, let's say. First of all, I describe in general as a first impact what I see. Okay, so we are here now. We stop in the middle of the square. In front of us, there is the monument that is huge, big, colorful. Some information, general information, as a first impact. After the impression, this building, let's say, this monument gives to me. So, is that big? Who I feel very small? I am impressed of the beautifulness in general of this monument. I felt small, big, important, whatever. Okay, so the feelings that I have close to this. Basically, we are describing visual things. Often are, let's call it art. And the art give emotion, give feelings. And if you want to describe art in general, modern, ancient, painting or sculpture or monument, you have to express your feeling watching the art. The art gives feelings, is one of the purpose of it. So explain somehow why you have those feelings. And in case, make similitude with something that you have close to your place or to the place of the traveler. So make some similitude with something that the traveler knows properly, or let's say that for sure you know that he knows. After that, start to enter in the details and describe more in specific what are you seeing. And what you think it's important to say. Okay, so again, we are in front of the Gothic, we have to focus in the windows, or we have to focus in the gargoyle, or we have to focus in the geometric of it, or we have to focus in the way of the building going until the sky, and so on. You can get lost, let's say, in whatever detail that according to your interest and according to your feeling, let's say, you think are important in this moment for that person who is close to you and for the reason why this person is traveling with you. So let's make an analysis, let's say. Let's start to enter in the analysis. One of the painting where I'm focus and stop during our tour in Venice is the Assumptions of Tiziano in Frari Church. We have a wonderful tour in Venice. We invite you to come to do it and to visit with us this wonderful city. And the Assumption of Tiziano, we stop it in front of it for some reason. One of these is that, of course, is very important painting. Another that I personally think is a reason to say some word is because there is God represented in this paint. It's not common. I mean, in Catholic religion, we can, let's say, represented God, and we do it more than Muslim or Jewish who doesn't at all. Anyway, so let's speak about this painting. First of all, it's divided in three. There is the downer part with the population, let's say. In the middle, there is the Holy Mary surrounded by angels. And in the upper part, the God, okay, is divided in three, one, two, three, but is also divided in two. There is the golden part, that is the upper part, with the Holy Mary and the God are surrounded by somehow a God color, and down a more normal color, let's say, no, a color of the earth, of the world, with the sky that is blue and let's say normal light. Of course, the Holy Mary and God are there is a light who underline their importance. I have to say in this moment that the red of the Holy Mary is the famous red of Tiziano. Tiziano was famous for several reasons. One of these is because he created his own red that was very famous, very liked in that time. Another detail that I often like to underline because make me laugh, there is God with the two angels on the left and right side, and one of them is bringing their crown. It's like I feel the God to the rush, no? To assumes to take with him Holy Mary, that he forgot to bring the crown, and there is this angel who brings the crown. This could be a completely fake, my personal interpretation. Maybe Tiziano want to make another, completely another things, but it's my interpretation, is what I saw, is the feeling that I had, okay? I think Tiziano want to share this. God, for the rush, forgot to bring their own crown. Maybe it's absolutely wrong. The important thing is to do not make believe to my traveler that what I'm saying is the historical truth. Okay? Perfect. After that, there is this the population that attracts my attention because they doesn't look so happy to the fact that Holy Mary is going in the sky. They are not celebrating, but somehow there are some hand going in the up, no, in the direction of the sky. And there are some faces who I feel, maybe I'm wrong again, that they are no, they try to keep the Holy Mary with them. And then you can also get lost in the face of the Holy Mary, the expression of it. So the description analysis and the question in which one, for example, of these three tomb that you have in front of you choose to describe. So which why I have to stop in front and speak in front of this tomb? I can pass in the middle of the church and saying in our left and right hand side there are many tombs of important people. Maybe I don't know who they are, so my traveler is interesting. Let's get closer and check who they are. Maybe they don't really are interesting. So walking, I just say there are tomb of important people. Some of them are very decorated. Anyway, my personally, I really like to describe and to enter in the detail of the tomb of Giovanni Pesaro, that is a Doge that died around 1618. One of the last doges of Venice, and there is a lot of symbology and details who impressed me. So I know basically this tomb since when I'm a child, and I share with my traveler. This tomb, first of all, to say it is divided in two, is quite a strongly different feelings. There is the upper part with the aristocratic, where there is in the center Giovanni Pesaro, the Doge, who is celebrating a bit himself with surrounded of other aristocratical symbologies of statues of people who is play aristocratical instrument, if we can call it like this. Someone who is reading, some statue of people who is reading, and down in the downer part there is the slave who are bringing in the shoulder all the upper part. So the Doge and the upper part are standing on the shoulder of the slave. This is very interesting. Also metaphorically, you can get lost. Okay, but in this case, we will just say that, as you can see, this is the slave. One of the details that impressed me a lot is this person who is handing some, let's say, technical information where usually are in the tomb, but this is not a regular skeleton. It's not just bones of a died person who usually you can easily find in some tomb, but it's something very weird. It's like a zombie, no? There is the nerve of this human. There is the skin very, very dry, let's say, and you can really feel the pain of this dying aspect. And there is another amazing, in my opinion, detail, who is the face of the servant, of the slave. You can see, thanks to the color game, black and white, with the marmor black, who is made this servant, who is African, basically, like the slave in that time, and the white marble of the eyes and the teeth of this man. And it's impressive, the work of the sculpture, that is a German one, but anyway, who described the details and the expression of this man. Those not little, in my opinion, particular, attract a lot my attention, and I want to describe it. So again, I describe the Giovanni Pesaro tomb, not because of Giovanni Pesaro, not because of his sculpture, but because of some details who I loved it, I like it, and attract my attention. So the reason of the description, okay? I already explained about the tomb. Now, for example, let's get 1 second in front of these three, let's call it church, even if the last is not a church, but is a temple. We have three images. The first is the Frari Church in Venice, where there is the tomb of Giovanni Pesaro and the Tiziano painting. I have to describe the facade. We arrive in front of the Frari before entering in our tour. So, of course, I have to say what basically about Frari, that is a weird style, is a mix between Roman and Gothic. Is Roman because it's very plain from decoration, the facade, I mean. And is Gothic because go in the upper in the direction of the sky with the classic Gothic windows, colorful, beautiful windows. Little parenthesis, windows made with Murano glass, technique from Venice, blah blah blah. So maybe now in Frari I get a bit lost in describing how they make those windows. Because we are speaking about Murano. So I use now the fact of beautiful, colorful windows to speak about something that is absolutely related to the city of Venice. So again, we say that is a brick facade, quite empty, with the three windows around, with the round shape, and there is the big facade in front of you, the main entrance, and in the end, very far from us, let's say, there is the tower of the church with another small facade that is the same of the big one, but smaller. Very funny, very beautiful, very cute. After that, we have another example that is the Milano Church's Duomo. Well, a poor Gothic, the biggest Gothic that we have in Italy. Here we can, I will say very fast, I will enter in the detail of the geometrical aspect that I can see. It's absolutely geometrical facade divided in two, right and left. In the central, there is like three level, the main door. And we go closer and we will describe the detail that I found close to the door. The upper part, there is a kind of balcony that is closed. And the third, let's say, floor, there is a beautiful decorated window. In the upper part, there are classic Gothic decoration. Do you know how are made the classic Gothic decoration? Absolutely not, yes. And then you enter in the detail if it's needed. And after, in the left part and the right part, again, there are other four doors in total, two and two. The third one is a temple in South America, in Mexico, and well, from far away, I don't see a lot. I will say that there is a lot of decoration, geometrical decoration. There is the face of someone, like there is the eyes, he, and the door is the mouth. Let's get a bit closer, and you will find some symbology, some details for sure are important to describe, to underline, to understand. In this case, we are far from our culture, so for sure, speak, let's get lost a bit in describing the symbology who we find in this monument. It's important. It's something that the traveler likes, let's say. So let's found some aspect where to focus in describing the things. And we say the geometry, okay? The geometry that I found in front of me. Especially for the monument, but not only. The color and the material, okay? This picture is from Gesù Nuovo in Naples, is a tripudium of Barocco, is huge combination of marble with different color, with thousands of details. Up to you, you can get lost in this church explaining, saying all the details that are you seeing. So I will just personally, I usually ask, we know everybody what does it mean Barocco. There is a lot of blue marble and white marble and so on. The details and the symbology of it, no? Again, this is the Milano Church Duomo, the details of Duomo and the sculpture of it. And after the information, historical information that I found confirm in what I'm describing. For example, in Venice, the church are not, they don't have a square in front of them, but often the church is looking the lagoon, let's say. In this example, I have for sure the confirmation the church is looking the lagoon without a square in front of the church. And after an analysis of details, as we take as example before. Okay, so the details, who I like it, and so analyzing them. The space is very important too. It's not only to describe what I'm seeing that is plain, can be a landscape, or can be the square and the space of the church or whatever monument in front of you, and you in the space. So how I usually describe San Marco Square with your hand, basically they should use the left hand of the person in front of you to understand better how is made San Marco Square, because here is the Basilica, there is the Doge's Palace, and in the fat tone there is a lagoon. Here there is the water and there is the lagoon. There is this little square where there is the Doge's Palace, that is historically very important, this little square, because there were a lot of celebration in this place and so on. Almost here there is the clock tower, that basically is not the clock tower, but hour of describing also the clock tower is very beautiful and important. Down part we say there is the Basilica, and after there is all the square around us in the space, according to where we are when we're doing this, that is closed from buildings made in Napoleonical time. So this is a way to describe, for example, the space where you are. That is important to do it. Again, here we are in the Basilica of Frari. And we can easily understand and feel the space that the square are not in front of the church, are beside the church. Okay, another landscape things is the Gulf of Naples. The Gulf of Naples, again, Quite easy. Take your right hand, we say to our traveler. In the downer part, close to you, there is the big dome, and this is the Sorrento Peninsula, where inside of the Gulf, that is the sea that is created by your hand, there is a Sorrento that is under Naples province. And in the other side of the peninsula, so down in the south, there is Amalfi. In front of this peninsula, there is Capri. Here, more or less, there is Vesuvio, close to the seaside. And after, there is Naples with Posillipo Hill. And after, Pozzuoli, and so on, and so on. In front of Pozzuoli, there is Procida and Ischia Island. So, according to this, according to what you are explaining about Naples, you can explain where you are in the space. For example, now we are in the seaside, we are in front of Posillipo, so we know almost more or less that if Posillipo was here, basically is meaning that we are here and so on. These are tips that helps you to describe things. Okay. Now I have a painting again of modern art full of details. Maybe we are in US traveling because this painting clearly brings us to US. Maybe we are in the restaurant, there is this painting. Maybe we are in a building, there is this painting. I will describe to our traveler. Describing this painting, generally information, a lot of things, a lot of symbology, let's say. Personally, I like it. There are a lot of remind to old Indians from America. There is the cowboy, there are a dinosaur, there is the classic car. Give me the freedom of America, and also the junk food from. No, this potato, the classic hamburger from McDonald's or whatever. And after there is also this interesting cross, Catholic cross, beside the street that is a bit weird. I don't know why. So I underline it because it's quite particular. So this is more or less what you have to say. No? Generally, the first impact that you have, the emotion, again, the element where there are. In this painting and the details who attract your attention. Another important street art is Banksy. And so, for example, we pass in front of his work and I have to describe. So, can be very easy to describing and also the message that he want to transmit or not. In this case, for example, it's quite easy. I think is the ATM that has a arm who takes a baby that looks like that he the arm of the ATM want to bring inside of it the baby. Why you can speak with him, her, I mean with your traveler and enjoy the debate, let's say. After there is another important things that is the baby who is losing or is leaving, I don't know, a balloon, a red balloon in a heart shape. And if I get closer, I can also see that there is a weird white effect on the black of the baby. Looks is an alien, is not, is just the reflect of the light. Let's see, who knows? But is are particular, are detailed, who maybe are important to share. Again, a mouse that in theory is from England because of the hat, who are playing with other kids. Which meaning there is behind this painting? Who knows? Let's see. Let's check on internet all together and let's give an interpretation, correct interpretation of it if you are interested. But the message behind the art, somehow it's important that the companion or the person who is in charge of describing do it, describing, and find a way to share this message. Now, after all this word, the question is what does it mean describe? What does it mean describe? We speak a lot, we give our word and we bring in word something that is visual, but this is of course our interpretation of the reality. The old definition of describing says that describing is the interpretation of the reality. So we have to avoid every influence or judgment in our describing process. And we have to try to describe content that permit somehow to them to see alone. For example, this souvenir object with there is in this case Colosseum, Duomo in Florence, Torre di Pisa, and Vatican Square are amazing because faster our traveler can touch the Colosseum and understand how it's made, how it looks like today, or how is made the St. Peter Square, and so on. So if you want to, you really want to use this tool when you're preparing your tour, could be that it's an idea to buy those souvenir models. Or anyway, if you don't buy, when you go in San Marco, you know that there are these shops who sell those stuff, and you ask the permission to touch it a moment for our travelers, and usually they let you do it. So there is another technique that is called Minolta that is very useful and not very expensive. If you want to, I think you easily find close to your place a person or organization who can print in Minolta. Minolta is like a paper sheet, okay, that thanks to a special machine and a special ink. This sheet became, let's say, 3D. So the black of the ink get fat, and you can feel it, and you can touch. For example, here we have two examples of the city center of Naples and the lagoon of Venice. In the very black part, there is the land with the small thin wave. We interpret, we realize the sea, and with other texture, we underline some part that we want to underline. So you create an instrument that is made for yourself. So exactly what you want to say. What I want to say about the city center of Naples, I want to speak about this, this, and this. So you underline with this different texture what you want to underline on the city center of Naples. Because this has every tactile path, let's say, cannot made in autonomy. The tactile aspect are often made with someone who helps the traveler to understand what he/she is touching. So we can, of course, if we receive enough comment behind and close to this webinar, if you really like and you are interested and you give us the reason, let's say, we are happy to create other webinar and similar to this one to explain how to create a model of Minolta technique, how to make a tactile path for your museum or these kind of things. For the moment, we just suggest you again contact some professionist and go to make some tactile visit properly structured. So touch, we were saying, is not enough because you have to know what you are touching. Before start to touching, in this case, I will say to my traveler, now we're going to touch the symbol of Carabinieri Italian Army. Did you ever touch the Carabinieri symbol? Maybe yes, maybe not. So here we are. First, I describe what you're going to touch. There is a ball that probably is a bomb with the fire on it. In the ball, bomb, there is the RI, Italian Republic, and with the fire that always goes in the right direction. And the traveler can make the tactile exploration. Now we can see another picture with some people who is touching, let's say, wall, columnas. So why we are touching those columnas? Because this is a part of Doge's Palace of Venice. So touching here, this part of the column, I can let you understand how is made the facade of Doge's Palace of Venice. So I use this column to help myself to let you understand the whole palace. Anyway, the touching moments are always needed. Okay? There is always the need. It's very important to help the traveler to touch with your help. You have to tell them, let's say, what they have to touch, the line that they have to follow. Okay? Here there is this, and after, if you go up, you find that details, and after, and so on, and so on, and so on. This is very important to guide the touched moment. Again, about touch, we can speak quite a lot. We could continue in another webinar. If you are looking for it, please tell us in the comment and we will do our best to prepare a new webinar. I hope that basically my information was clear, and I hope that I give you some beautiful and interesting hints. Please don't hesitate to contact us and to make many comments under this video or in the webpage inclusionplatform.io. We hope that you discover this platform and could be useful for your job, or you can bring some contents and your contribution in it to increase this world of mixed ability group and to inclusion in general for people with disability in this case, but not only. So I hope again to see you soon in our channel, in our social network, and subscribe yourself to our YouTube page. Have a nice day, and see you soon.